Hey, how you doing today?
I'm good, man. How are you?
Hey, so great to see you, man. I'm wondering why you're applying for this job today.
Well, you know, I've always been told that I should be like in a bodyguard or getting a bodyguard work, and I think it'd be good, and I'm really interested in going down that path.
Well, what do you see in your future in this job here?
Well, you know, maybe I can get some high clients and get up there, maybe even have my own company one day.
Absolutely. Do you understand what you're doing?
Yeah, basically just watching over people, make sure no one messes with them, yeah.
Oh, bodyguard is definitely not what this title is. It's a sex worker, sir.
Are you kidding me?
I'm not.
Do you think I'd be a good sex worker?
Let's go. We just gotta go hard. I go the hardest. I bring the pain.
Boom, 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 chicka-bow.
What's up, my man? How we doing today?
We're doing fantastic, man.
How was your week?
It was good. Yeah. It was good. How was yours?
Oh, fantastic. I had a lot of good things going on last week, and looking forward to what we're going to start talking about here today. I mean, you know.
Wait a second. Are you taking the job or not?
No, I didn't take the job.
Did you turn down the job?
No, I already told you. I can't hang out with Samuel Jackson.
I don't think he wanted that job.
Not in that capacity. I didn't want that job, period.
That's hilarious. Well, everybody, welcome to Off the Script Podcast.
Episode number 2.
It is.
Spit some fire.
It is. And what do we talk about, Joe?
You know, on this platform, if you're not familiar, we're going to talk about current events, sports, life experiences.
Yes.
You know, a little motivation here and there. We're just going to, you know, basically we're just going to be bantering and talking shit like we always do, and we're going to have a good time. And, you know, I think we might need to go ahead and lead it off with the NFL this last week.
Love it. I'm following you, man. What are we?
Well, I want to get into something pretty deep in about this officiating that's going on. And it's every game. There's a blown call. And, you know, being a Raider fan, there's a lot of calls that are never called. And it's at the point now you argue with people. Oh, you don't know what you're talking about. But there's proof. And the thing I really want to get into is I did a little research. And what's amazing to me is the NFL – with all the teams, is worth $165 billion.
Wow.
Okay? That, the MLB and the NBA, if you add up their teams and how much they are worth, it doesn't even come close.
Yeah.
The average salary for a player in the league is $750,000. And then it goes up every year.
Yeah.
And it gets up to the $1 million mark after year 3. And those numbers should be a little higher, in my opinion, too, after all these, after what all the owners make and the shield itself. Now, the refs... the top I saw was $200,000 a year. A lot of referees have other jobs. They don't have a full-time job.
Yes.
Am I the only one that's fucking this, doesn't think this is fucking crazy and absurd? It wouldn't be a problem if you paid them full-time and had them train all year, study the rules all year, make sure the right call is correct, and the whole reviewing process needs to change. Yeah. Now, I think Mark does have a clip you can bring up, right?
Yeah, which one?
The Chief game.
The one that you sent? Yeah.
Yeah, the Chief game. And this is a perfect example when you watch it here on the screen here.
This was a crazy play.
This isn't a hole.
Really was.
Look at this.
That's unbelievable.
And that's not called.
Yeah, unbelievable.
They could. He's exactly right.
How's that not a hole? Yeah. This is the ice.
But when you watch this right here,
yeah.
this is ticky-tack.
Sunday Night Football gets intercepted. The ref throws the flag.
After there's too much time that went by.
Let's see the flag. Let's see the hold here.
They're both. That's offensive or defensive. Let him play football
really
like he says.
Ticky tack.
Let the boys play. That is absolutely unreal. Robert Saleh cannot believe.
He was furious.
His job's on the line.
Dude, he was pissed.
His job's on the line.
So what's your rebuttal to this?
Well, I will just say it just brings me back to, you know, the old sayings of you know, is football rigged? And, you know, like, I don't think so, you know, but at the same time, you know, it's like with the refs being paid, there's nepotism in there. So, like, it's passed down, and I feel like they should be getting paid more.
Well, they should be taken care of more, because the thing is, it's like, you know, $200,000 a year to do that, and you do it. You know,
you watch Hard Knocks.
Yeah,
have you seen the Steve Smith experience
where he goes on
episodes and he does different jobs in the NFL, being a great receiver. When he did the ref shop, they really, you know, they go hard for trying to get these guys into shape for the NFL season. Well, they have to fix it,
and there should be a union for them. Let's call it what it is.
Well, should we just go to cameras and just get rid of all refs?
Well, I mean,
That's what no one ever wants to do.
I mean, MLB does the same thing.
We want the human aspect of it.
And what's just going to happen right now? Everybody knows that the MLB playoffs have started.
Right.
And they're going to see all these calls now at home, because when everybody really watches baseball, and they're going to zoom on in and have the square around the strike zone, you're going to see the ball inside, outside, being called strikes and all the calls. And until they do a different way, it's going to be a problem. It's going to be a problem. And again, it's about money. Take care of them.
Yeah.
Everybody needs to be taken care of more.
I don't want to spend too much time on here, but I just do want to say that, you know, at the end of the day, man, I mean, how many times do the old heads have to say, we need the human aspect of the game?
Well, yeah, they all say it. They all say it.
That's why it's still there. Well, and there should be cameras. And the game might be a little longer, but
yeah,
we'll get every call right.
Yeah, they would.
Yeah.
So what you want to get into now?
I think we should get into maybe a question.
Okay.
What
you got for me, man? This motherfucker always wants to ask these questions. Well, actually, I got him last week.
You did. You want to do flip the script first?
No, we'll do the question.
Okay, let's do a question. Here we go. We would take forever. So how do sports intersect with society, man? What is like some of the history of sports? Like, since we just got off that subject, what do you what would you say sports, the history, how it came out, like the beginning of sports? What was it made for?
Fuck, that was loaded. Yeah, that's a good question.
Really easy question.
I mean, if you want to go back to gladiator times, and I remember when I was at Fresno State studying theater history, you know, when they would have those times, and if it was in the theater, if they even had the gladiator fights, you know, all the more expensive seats then, even then it wasn't expensive when they were doing gold or their trade or whatever, would be by the pit, they'd call it.
Right.
And they wanted to be seen because they wanted to see the entertainment.
Yeah.
So I think in the end of the day, it's entertainment, but I think 50, 60 years ago, it was a sport, and now it's more entertainment. And I think it's crazy how people really get connected to teams. I mean, I've talked about it now. I'm Raider Nation. I'm tattooed. Okay. Yeah. And now I have to deal with that the rest of my life, and I'm fine with it. But some people don't get it, and then they move around. And I think it's so, because it's so different now, because it's entertainment, it's gambling, it's fantasy football, it's everything, or fantasy sports in general, because there's a fantasy league in every sport.
Yeah. Big time.
You know, what do you think about that?
I mean, you said it, bro. Yeah. I mean, that's where sports originated from. It was definitely
started way back, you know. I mean,
that's why the Coliseum was built.
I need to go see the Coliseum.
That's why it was built. Yeah, definitely.
Or like in Gladiator.
I think it takes
you see the Coliseum Maximus. Oh, Rome.
Yeah, I think it takes the eyes off of what's really going on in life, though. If you really want to get into it.
No, it does. It does. And, you know, that's...
It's a banter to keep people busy.
Exactly. Yeah, everybody likes it because it's a stress relief from what they're going on in life. And they want to
escapism,
enjoy it.
Escapism.
It's escape. Absolutely.
It always is.
That's a perfect word for it. Absolutely. Yeah, but, I mean, we love them.
Yeah, we do.
We'll be talking about them a lot, you know. I guess we're that other percent that definitely, you know, chooses to look the other way on that stuff, so... It is what it is.
Yeah, it is for sure.
For sure. Flip the script time.
Yeah, let's do it.
Let's do it.
All right. So we got a few photos, and I threw something in there, too.
Oh, love it.
Of course you did.
So let's start with this. 3, 2, 1.
Bam.
Mr. Tom Hanks.
Mr. Tom Hanks.
Beware, there's a video out there promoting some dental plan with an AI version of me. I have nothing to do with it.
I heard that on the radio, actually.
See, here we go. This is what the problem is going to be. You know, this was for a dentist ad or commercial, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, commercial.
And what are you doing? Like, and they're just lazy. It's cheap production. I mean, we can go, as Mark knows.
I think it's also like right now, because it's the Wild Wild West and they haven't actually put in restrictions and whatnot, that you can get away with some of this. Eventually, you would be fined heavily for that.
Right, hopefully. And I think that's what's going to be longer on the table, because if anybody doesn't know the writer's strike, it's not on paper, it's not sealed and delivered, but that strike looks like an end. Now SAG is at the table, and this is the biggest thing right here.
The timing.
Yeah, for sure. I don't know if they leaked it out or what happened, but I mean, it's crazy.
I think it's mainly because it's a Tom Hanks name connected to it, you know. But there's been, you know, teases of this for a long time. But the fact that it's Tom Hanks and that he's, you know, actually taken, you know, some note to it and made a statement about it, you know, blogs and the news is going to pick all of that up. So
what do you think? What do you think the percentage of chance that SAG actually planted this and made somebody do that so that they could use it as leverage in negotiations?
I mean, that's
that would be that's dirty, but I wouldn't rule it out. I just wouldn't rule anything out anymore. I wouldn't be surprised. Nothing surprises me anymore.
If he thought of that right now, in 10 seconds, 15 seconds after what we just talked about, then
that's what he does, though.
we produced this commercial. Right. All right. We got
Mastermind Media.
All right. 3, 2, 1.
What we got? Oh, yeah. We ain't brought this guy up yet.
Where do you start?
I mean,
you know, you know what I do like about him?
Yeah.
He's a fucking gambler, bro. Like, seeing all these videos, he plays 100,000 a hand.
Crazy.
He's kicked out of casinos because he gets them. Like, he plays blackjack. He plays it well. And I've seen some of the crazy stuff. Now, back to his business.
UFC.
Whew, I mean.
Dana White.
You know what? And I don't know the man in... You know, we always see the negative stuff. We don't see anything else he does. But, you know, the MMA is run a little bit different than any other mainstream sports. I mean, you got people that come in there and they've had these pasts where they've criminal activity and everything else. Yeah. I mean, I like how they're trying to change their game. But there's also been a lot of people that are in prison because of their actions as being a fighter, you know, outside of being a fighter. So,
you know, but it's the same thing in the NFL.
True.
You know, I mean, but at the same time, you know, I definitely agree with what you're saying. You know, he's been painted but you know, he kind of puts himself in that box. But he created UFC, bro.
Yeah.
And if you want to say it's mob style run, you know, where they don't really give out contracts, they're changing people's lives and they give people money that would never have a chance.
Right. Exactly.
You know, that just you know, so for me, I really like Dana. You know, I mean, I don't agree with his, you know, his political views or whatnot, but outside of that,
that's what's beautiful about America. He can do whatever he wants.
He created a fantastic business and he believed in himself. And yeah, I heard a story about gambling while you talked about that. He was like $400,000 or $500,000 in and then came back and won like $3.5 million.
He's crazy, bro. I mean he has the money to do it.
He saves people too.
Yeah, he's his friends, I see some good things from him. So
I remember when I think it was the Jake Paul fight got canceled last minute.
Yeah.
And I got to kind of see into his mindset as far as like how business savvy he is. It's like, you know what I think happened? I think it's hard to sell out Madison Square Gardens and it's hard to get people to come to New York and travel all the way. So they probably didn't sell as many seats because I never really think about that when you're throwing an event or something. But for him to have that knowledge and just to see what he would do differently, it's like, it's hard. And it shows how hard this business is and the fact that he's had a successful
one. Well, going off what you just said, I mean, that's the thing about Vegas.
Yeah.
Vegas has everything there now. I mean, they got women's basketball, hockey, football. They're going to have a baseball team. They have motocross. They have rodeos. They have everything. Everybody can come to Vegas. And that's why the fights have always been so popular there.
Yeah.
Because there's so much action going around, you know?
Isn't that where your job interview was earlier?
It might have been.
But that's now, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, in the 90s, right? In the 90s, they weren't, you know.
Well, Vegas, they still had a lot of fights there.
Yeah, I feel you.
And Atlantic City was like the biggest.
Having fights in Saudi Arabia.
Yeah, I know.
What we got next, Mark?
All right, 3, 2, 1. FEMA to conduct trial of emergency alert system.
Hey, you got to explain that, Joe. What's up?
So did everyone get this alert on their phone today?
What's the date today?
Today is the 4th,
October.
Right?
Yeah, October 4th.
Yeah, it was between 11:15 and 11:30. You were supposed to get a notification on the radio, phone, TV. They were supposed to do this whole broadcast and make sure it works.
Right.
And it was interesting because when I saw it, I go, okay. But the thing is now, I mean, they have everyone's information.
Yeah.
They have everyone's, you know, how they have all that is what's crazy to me about it. Mm-hmm. But I also think they're still, you know, everybody's trying to cover their ass because what happened in Lahaina.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think they came together that, you know, quick to do it, but they had this plan all along. And is it a good thing? Yeah. But it's also crazy that they can hit my phone like that, you know? But I think that's, it was that's a, what the world we live in.
I think it was an upgrade to the system, and they were just trying to try out the
new. Yeah, of course, yeah.
But it was definitely, if you do break it down, you know, I mean, will that save people's lives? Yes.
Yes, you hope so.
I mean, look, what is it? Probably like 75, 80% of the world, you know, they're on their phone, you know, like probably like 50% of their day.
50, you're damn right. Because so. you're so right about that. You go to places, wherever it is, restaurants, bars, shopping centers, where if someone's helping you out, they're just sitting there texting while they're doing, you know what I mean? They just, everything, the phone is attached to their hip.
Yeah, absolutely.
I wish I could throw it down the street, but whatever.
I see this.
I had, so today, Gary Vaynerchuk is like my North Star as far as like marketing, right?
Right.
And I share his content a lot and use it for how we think about marketing for our clients digitally. Right. And so smart today, as soon as that happened, which that happened, was it everybody in the United States? Is that?
Yeah.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah.
So I think 10 minutes after, he had a post already on Instagram. It's a picture of him like at a speech or something. And it looked like your iPhone cover, and it had like the alert on it. And it said, this is not a test alert. And it said, you now have been motivated to go live your dreams or something. So not only did everybody just go through that, 10 minutes later, he has a post.
Yeah, that's amazing.
So everybody that sees it is like, oh my God, amazing. They relate with it immediately.
Yeah.
And that's some next level shit.
That that's deep, bro.
Well, I mean, just to be
just be savvy about that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Why didn't you do that?
Now I'll be prepared moving forward.
That was quick. Yeah, I mean, quick. He had to learn that you can
be that savvy. And right. Prepare for that. Because you can prepare for events and say the Super Bowl. Okay, what do we want to do strategically when so-and-so scores a touchdown? But that is just on a whole new level.
It is.
Nobody does it like them.
Facts. That was a good one.
Yeah.
That was a good one. What we got next, man?
All right, so this is the last one I threw in here. And I sent something to you guys before. And what I want you guys to do for this is maybe a future segment called like Scenario.
Okay.
Well, we'll take a couple different things, throw it in. And what I want to hear from you guys is flip the script with this. Who are these guys? And what are they about to do?
That's funny.
Who are these guys? And are they about to go to? Are they about to?
Oh my God, bro! That's awesome.
That is awesome.
Holy shit! I mean, bro, that's some next level shit there.
to answer that question though, that was a good. This is dope.
And for our audio listeners, it's an AI generated version of Joe and Lance in suits.
Yeah.
Probably $5,000 suits.
Yeah.
$5,000
and like probably like 10 or 20 pounds lighter.
So where are these guys? Where are these guys?
At least me, not you. You look good, not me.
Where are you guys headed?
Hey, man.
Oh, we going to go take care of some business. we going to be the Twin Towers, not the 12. We can say Twin Towers. We're both big dudes.
I would say this is we made it photo, right? This is where you're, you know, maybe at your wedding.
You gonna say wedding to me? I don't even have anybody. I mean,
man, the future's bright, man. You know,
someone
you never
over,
know.
Man, maybe
it's
someone.
So bright, he's got a shade zone.
Yeah, but this, someone I'll running the show there might wedding. Be different.
You guys are at my wedding?
Yeah. The bodyguards at his wedding.
Bodyguards at his wedding.
It looks like funny. Somebody like one of the somebody's doing some shady shit. And you guys spot him.
We see it going on.
Yeah, exactly. You about to go fuck him up?
That's
no. I mean that dude. That's a.
So good. I would absolutely wear that outfit too.
And you
I
know got, that you would got wear two that. Pocket one. Squares.
I know, right?
God damn.
Yeah.
That's dope. That's a fit.
That's
right
really
there.
Cool fit, man.
That's awesome, Mark. That's awesome. Thank you, bro. That's
you
awesome.
Got it. You got it.
Speaking of, he said Tupac. What'd you think about hearing about it? What happened this week, early this week?
Oh, I didn't know you were going to talk about that.
Hell yeah, I want to talk about that because I just I find it just.
Dude told on himself.
I don't even know what the word is for it.
Because, he told himself.
Yeah, but it's just. Doesn't make any sense. It took him that long to. I mean, especially with all the book being out and everything, right?
You know why it took that long, man? They didn't want to give any fire to any of that stuff Tupac was talking. And then Keefe actually did a good job at offsetting it on Orlando. And then it conveniently, and a couple weeks later, Orlando died. You know, and then he blamed it on him. You know, a dead man. So I mean, at the end of the day, he's the one who was out in those interviews. Saying the stuff he was saying.
Yeah, he did. Yeah.
And that's how the FBI, picked the case up and charged him with it. But did you hear what Suge said?
No, I didn't hear what Suge said.
Oh, yeah, Suge. They interviewed him. You know, they jumped on that quick. I mean, I think I even heard it on CNN. They interviewed him and asked him about what was going on, if he knew anything about it. And he said everybody in L.A. knew who killed Tupac.
Wow.
And he said it was him?
He really didn't say it was him because he wasn't going to, you know, he's in jail right now. He can't tell on anybody because then that's a death sentence. Yeah. But, you know, he kind of alluded to the fact, I would say. But, you know, he was like, I know Keefe D from back in the day and da-da-da-da-da. And, you know, we used to play junior varsity basketball together and, you know, all types of stuff. So, wow. I don't know, man. Yeah, I mean, the Vlad TV interviews, bro.
They always get them.
Bro, they get you, bro. They will get you. I don't know what you was thinking.
Right?
Oh, man. What you want to talk about, man? I think we should get on a little bit more NFL because there's something else I want to knock out.
Okay.
Because we're at the four-week mark.
I'm good with it, right?
We discussed the four-week mark.
Four-week mark.
Yeah, so there's an image right here that Mark's going to be pulling up. I want your opinion on these leaders of these divisions. I mean, at week four,
when I look at this whole thing, my two surprises when I watch, look at this.
I know what you're going to say.
It's Tampa and Indy. But Indy at 2-2 at the head of that division is just weird to me.
4-0, San Fran and the Eagles. I mean, that's the only two teams. At this point, usually there's about four or five teams.
Well, I mean, yeah, no, exactly. But now it's just, I mean, dude, it's changed so much. I mean, I'm really happy to see this for you. I love seeing that. That's great.
I forgot
especially
to say.
In that division. I mean, how dominant Green Bay has been.
Read this off really quick for our listeners. AFC East.
AFC East. The Buffalo Bills are 3-1. AFC North. The Ravens are 3-1, which isn't a surprise.
Right.
AFC South, 2-2 with the Colts.
Crazy.
Okay. AFC West, not a surprise. 3-1. The Chiefs. NFC East, 4-0. The Eagles. In my opinion, not a surprise. The Dallas Cowboy fans will probably think differently, but whatever. I mean, NFC North, I don't think it's 3-1 Lions. Now,
wow.
I've been doing pods in this room for about a year now, and right. I talked about the Lions last year, and you know what? I love it.
Yeah.
Dan Campbell, he's doing a fabulous job.
Good for him.
They believe in him. They're doing a good job, and it's really nice to see that happen. The Bucks 3-1 with Baker Mayfield.
That's crazy.
A big surprise.
Yes.
And then the Niners in the NFC West. It's not a surprise. They've got everything they need. That team is locked and loaded and ready
Purdy.
To go.
Who's the best team in the NFL?
I would probably have
right now,
to say.
At 4 week, Mark. That's exactly what I was going to ask, Mark. Good shit.
I would say the Niners. And I hate saying that, but I'm going to look at that and say the Niners. I mean, if you want to go back, I mean,
Bills put a smacking on Miami, and
yeah,
Miami looked like the best team in the NFL.
And you know
before
what
they got?
They're the best offensive team.
Yeah, yeah,
they're the best offensive team. But
Purdy's San Fran, bro. He came out of nowhere, dude.
All right. And the Chiefs still are up there too, you know. Yeah. But I just that's crazy.
Who did they lose to?
Who?
Chiefs. Who's their loss?
Nah, they had a scare against the Jets last week, but
sure lost.
Let's call it what it is. A call.
There's
a couple
that's
calls.
The video we
there's
played.
A call,
yeah.
There's a call in every damn game that just turns everything over.
That was ridiculous.
Right, right.
I mean, you know, I hope you don't bring up the Raiders. I did get my blood pressure checked earlier today, and it's okay. But now if we start talking about that shit, I get
this
mad.
This
is
this
I
image.
Love
it. That's
I love
it. That's it.
I love it.
I want to take this in a different direction. A little crazy segue, right? Let's get into... what it's like, and we talked about this before, so I know it would be good content to for the pod, but what's it like to get a physical as a man, and like, you know, I know you've been to the doctors with situations, you know,
with,
right with
now,
your
yeah,
eyes
yeah, right yeah.
now, but like, what's it like? Like, what's
you
the
never
breakdown?
Had a physical?
I have, but I'm just saying.
Why
are
you asking me for?
Well, are you prepared for colonoscopy?
I'm working on that right now, which is not fun at all.
Let's discuss it.
You have to do it at a certain age, and the way the insurances are working, like I was ignorant to the fact of how it all works. I have to have a consultation first before I actually have the procedure.
Right.
I can't get a consultation until November 27th. I've been trying to get this done for a while now. I mean, I had everything going on with Howie and the loss of my dog and everything, and there was some bad. I was supposed to schedule it. And then I called him. And go, well, you have to get a consultation. Well, no one told me that.
Yeah.
So I have to get the consultation over the phone, and then I'll get the procedure done. And so, then when I get the procedure done, maybe we can put the picture up there and see if my colon's good.
We'll have to do that, bro.
You know, but I think it's...
What's it like, though, going into the doctors? What do they exactly do? They still grab your balls and make you cough?
No, I haven't had that in a while. I mean, I think that was more of a... That was like, you know, when you play sports and stuff like that. I mean, hernias are very common in males, and they can live with them forever and everything else. But, you know, I mean, you go in there, you talk to them about what's going on. It's more of a conversation, and then... You know, I mean, it was a couple years ago, and we're going to go back to this with Mark because it's great. I mean, I went to a doctor. He was a family practicing doctor. He was an orthopedic.
Mm-hmm.
And I talked to him about my aches and pains, and he asked me how much wheat do I consume.
Yeah.
And he explained to me about all the chemical that's in wheat now, not like the 70s. And I think we don't look at that. And that's why we have a lot of problems. I mean, I can't drink beer like I used to.
Right.
Because I just feel inflamed. And some people can't. I can't. I feel like shit the next day. And, you know, it's even with some, like, you know, if I do have a sandwich, I'm careful about the bread I have.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't eat a lot of pastas, even though I did last week, but it was at a great Italian restaurant. But the thing is, it's like, you sit there and you chat about what's going on in life, and then you got to get your blood test done. And then when you read, see, I think it's funny when I talk to some people that are older than me, and don't know what numbers are, or don't know what the test is, or what they're doing.
Right.
Like ALT, I believe it's ALT, your level levels. Like, people don't know what that means.
Yeah.
Your good cholesterol versus your bad cholesterol, and the overall, they don't understand about triglycerides and all that stuff. And it's because I know it pretty much, because I had a relationship with a couple nurses. One was longer than it should have been, but every relationship that goes bad goes too long anyways. But she taught me a lot about all that shit, so I know about it. And so, it's important.
Well, I'll let you run off there right there, because everybody needs to hear, you know, that type of stuff.
No, man. They
There's
do. A lot of people and, that you know, don't. I get a physical once a year.
There are people that, you know, don't want to go to the doctor.
Yeah, well, I don't want to go
either.
They
don't think it's right, you know?
Yeah, I don't want to go either.
But me and our friend Dana White up there that we put up before, he says, if I get a broken arm, I'm going to go home and I'm going to fix it myself. I don't want to, you know? So, yeah, I mean, but a lot of people are scared, man. So I feel like what you just said was dope.
They're scared because, I mean, it's the way you live your life.
Right.
And you know what? I enjoy getting it done every year. I try to clean up as much as possible before I go in. And then, you know, the last couple of years, I've seen where my weight has gone. And, like, I got weighed today, and I'm down a little bit more. I was up when Howie went, because I was grieving. But now I'm seeing it already move. Yeah, and I'm just starting to do little things again, you know, and then changing some stuff up, which I have to. And I think that's the most important thing is when you get into it, when you have a physical and you look at your numbers, it's like, well, you can just go ride it out and die, or you can try to change it. It's up to you. And when I see him, like, I know what I need to do.
We don't have that much time left, right? We got to make the
right decisions. And that's why, like I'm saying, it's important. And, you know, my parents still, being my age, she presses the button on me. I have friends that do it. I mean, and you just, if you want it, you got to take care of yourself. And that's the other thing, too. I talked to, it was strange, a while back, I was talking to someone when I was working, and we were talking about football, and we were talking about Dion getting that toe cut off, and he looked at me, he goes, he doesn't take care of himself.
Yeah, I think that was more of just his body being like...
Well, I mean, you know, I mean, I know diabetics, you know, I mean, we have a friend, you know, and I mean, he didn't take care of himself, and they get their, it's just sad. If you just stop
it's a plague, man.
No, and it's also... It's mentally, it's physically, it's all the same thing. You got to want to do it. If you can't, then you get help for the mental part. You know what I'm saying? So I think everybody should try to take themselves better, you know? And I know I've done some bad things and put my body, and I try to stop doing that, and I know what it is, and it's all in moderation.
All right. Speaking of moderation, Kevin McCarthy. Let's talk about him. Can you believe that?
Yeah, I can believe it.
I mean,
if you really want to get deep,
eight Republicans
I get it.
Vote that through.
I get it. But if you really want to get into it, when you look at the whole system and why I don't like talking about it, because it's a complete shit show. I mean, how embarrassing it is being American that you had the last two presidents, the current president, the last president, were both up for impeachment. Think about that for a minute.
Well, I mean, it's the woke culture right now.
You know, how'd you feel about that, Mark?
Which part?
Him getting ousted as a House Speaker in first time in, like, what was it, 60-something, 70-something years?
Well, I just think that overall there's so much that needs to change. And you know, I say it a billion times about how the internet helps us at least have a right. amplify our voices and everything too. And I think right. there's a, you know, people holding people accountable. So,
they banned Nancy Pelosi too today. Mm-hmm. They banned her from, they cleaned her quarters out for her to get trash bags.
Wow.
All the stuff she's done for the, you know, that's neither here nor there, right. but yeah, that was crazy, man.
It is crazy. It's
I think it also it warns people for the future and everything too. So like, you want to hold these high positions.
Yeah.
You know,
things have changed too much. Everybody can see what you're doing now.
Right.
You know, it's not like it was back in the day.
Facts.
You know, it's anything you do. You got everybody's watching you. You know, I mean, everybody can see you. You know. So.
Hey, I wanted to kind of do something new too.
Okay.
That I thought was fun.
All right. He's all about fun and games today.
Eventually we'll get this right, but I kind of wanted to do like a would you rather type of little thing here. So I have a couple of them, and we can all answer.
Yeah, that's fine with me.
But
you got something you want to do later. You got a question to ask us later too, right?
Yeah, I got some old photos of Lance I found.
Well, way to spoil it. Way to spoil it, Joe. Why do you have to bust it out like that, right?
I found a couple old photos.
I can't wait to see this. It's probably me, but whatever the fuck it is.
I can't wait to see what he's got going too.
I don't know what's going shit.
So we got a would you rather?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Here we go.
I like that. That's perfect. That's perfect for that. Boom, boom, boom. So let's do, would you rather have the ability to pause time whenever you want or never need sleep again?
Ooh.
Think about that one.
Ooh.
You could pause time whenever you want or never need sleep again. That contrast.
Now, hold on now, because if you never had sleep, would it affect you if you never had sleep again? Because if you never had sleep, it doesn't make
infinite,
any sense.
This is infinite on both sides.
I'd pause time.
Okay.
I would like to sleep again, actually. I like sleeping.
Okay.
I don't get to sleep enough.
See, that's why it's
I like to get my rest, and I've talked about that a lot. I need to get my rest.
You know what I would pause time for most, maybe? Would be like, you know, when you're in a moment and you do catch yourself in that moment, you're like, damn, like this, and then it fleets.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah. Or something great.
That. Yeah, you'll be able to pause that and be able to really take it in.
Right.
And you know, we always talk about with phones and taking photos and all that stuff. You can pause time and really live in that moment and really like acknowledge and appreciate everything that's around you, and then push play again, like click or something.
Right.
But yeah, I think I would say the same.
You would
what
say
about it? You, Lance? Yeah, pause time.
Pause time.
Pause time.
Because look, if you're about like not to take it there, but imagine if you're something bad's about to happen to you and you can,
yeah, for sure.
You know, pause time. Regroup, figure out the best way, just like they do.
But this goes back to like, the other part of that question was like, never sleeping again. Could you imagine if I never slept, how I'd look?
Yeah, I
look like a fucking zombie.
But
bro.
If it didn't matter to you, like that's the question. Like, it didn't matter.
I would still want to sleep, I think. That'd be fucking
You didn't
weird.
Need to sleep, so you could devote all your time to everything you want to accomplish.
Yeah, that's really, it's great too. But,
yeah,
everybody's sleeping when you're, so you could be working while they're sleeping.
They're sleeping, but it's tough.
Yeah.
You work when you sleep anyways, don't you? Right?
I did, not anymore. Yeah.
And this is relative to, right?
Right.
Another post question. Would you rather have your dream job, right, with a lower salary or a high-paying job with something you don't enjoy?
Man, my dream job would be to bet the horses every damn day. There ain't no damn job on that.
Think of the question, though.
I get it.
What would you say? Mark, I think you know already. What would you say, Mark? Let him ponder.
Yeah, dream job.
Dream job for sure.
Dream job,
bro.
Dream job.
I mean, when you get to those other ones that they pay higher and everything, there's so much stresses behind it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You got so many... I think there's a lot of people that they don't do what they love ever. They go ahead and settle.
Yeah, there's a lot of people out there that do have a job they hate that they're making a lot of money.
Yeah, they make a lot of money, bro.
Super depressed.
Super
depressed because that's all they do, and they don't do any outlets or anything else for
it. Once you have that much money, to quote a great movie called Two for the Money, how much money do you have to actually win to actually feel something?
Right.
And like that, eventually, once you get everything, you don't need anything else. Then you don't have anything to really live for or drive.
Yeah, that's true.
That's why I agree. The same thing, man. I mean, you don't definitely do not want to be stuck in that rat race.
Right. That's what we all are. Yeah. In a rat race.
And even money can't, you know, if it's something you don't enjoy, it's gonna be just it's not gonna be good for you at all. Yeah. We see that all the time.
That's pretty good, Lance. I like that.
Yeah, would you rather, man? I think that might stick.
Yeah, I like that. Right out of left field.
That is right out of left field. I don't think we should call it. Would you rather?
What would you call it?
Coming out of left field.
What would you say?
Coming out of left field. Coming out of left field, because that's who you are. You left field Lance.
Maybe just out of left field.
Out of left field. Okay, out of left field. I like that better.
Comment.
Right. You know, we can go ahead and coming out of left field, and we can have Joe Rose Corner.
Oh, I like that too. Okay. Pip that really quick.
Yeah, you know, I think that's a good idea. Maybe our listeners will let us know about that. But I think that'd be a good idea.
Yeah, like Joe Rose Corner, nice little monologue once a week.
Yeah, you know, I can always do that. You know, I can start writing. I got monologues I can do whenever I want.
How do you feel about like steak sauce? And then you just go on a rant.
I don't like steak sauce. See, steak. When you go to places, he just started. This is great. See. Dude, A1 is shit. I don't want no A1 sauce. There shouldn't be any sauce on a steak.
How do you get your steak cooked?
Medium rare, bro.
That's the only way.
It's the only way to do it. Hey, I mean, it's the only way to do it.
Yeah,
rare's good, but you know, you got motherfuckers when they do well done or extra well done. What the fuck? You want jerky?
Yeah, they do. They don't want to see no pink, no blood.
No, I mean, I like medium rare. That's the only way to get a steak. And I like ribeyes. I like to have a ribeye.
See, now, I'll be real. Mid rare is a little, like, if it's a good cut, right, I'll definitely do mid rare. But if it's like a sirloin, top sirloin, or like, you know, just not a good, great cut of steak, I'm going to do medium, you know,
for
sure.
I'm with you on that. You know? I can do that.
Like I'm not gonna do well done.
I could eat it, but it's like when you like I might be sick tomorrow because like when you look at that meat, you're like.
Now let me ask you a question: how do you get your burgers?
Oh man, I cannot do no. I'm straight up. I'm definitely not doing no mid rare or rare hamburger meat. I promise you, dude.
What about you?
I'm medium. Medium.
Yeah. Medium at least.
Rare burgers are weird, man.
Oh. I eat a half pound of ground beef every day now.
Do you?
Yeah.
Good for you. I do that about twice a week.
Medium, put some bell peppers on there and a couple eggs on top. That's my lunch every day.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's a good meal. You got a lot of protein and a lot of good stuff in there.
Man, I had a dude a while back. I was working. This is funny ass story. And like one of the dudes I work with were friends. I don't want to drop his name on here.
Of course.
But we were working. This fucking guy orders a glass of milk. This is at the fucking bar. A glass of milk in a hamburger with fries. And he wanted the burger just plain. And he was a grown-ass man.
Rare?
No, just a plain burger with nothing with on hamburger. It. Just a hamburger in the bun. Like,
and dude, a glass of milk.
And a glass of milk.
Fucking
Home Alone. Yeah.
Four, five, 6 years old, bro. Like, what's going on?
I used to love a cold glass of milk.
Nah, man, I did too. I can't fuck with it no more. I can't be doing it.
Speaking of cold glass of milk and kids, what? I got something for us on that. So what is most memorable nursery rhyme? You guys were spitting in it a little bit, but what's some things that you come to your mind, man? Like some funny things.
See, you can't ask me that because the first thing I fucking think about is Hickory Dickory Dock, and then I think of fucking Dice. When he came out with them fucking, those stories, you know, Andrew Dice Clay, exactly, he came out all that shit. That's what I think about now. I don't think about the other shit. I can't remember that.
Well, the people, you know, it's really popping right now. People are talking about this all the time, the nursery rhymes that we remember and stuff, in that Rub-A-Dub Tub, Who Are the Three Men in the Tub? I don't remember that.
No, I told you. I just remember what Dice said, because when that came out, that was so
funny.
What
about like Humpty Dumpty? You remember? Well, no, Humpty Dumpty
a little bit. I mean, I don't know.
Mary Had a Little Lamb.
Mary ain't having no fucking lambs.
This guy, dude. You know what about you? That shit?
I do a little bit.
I probably go like Dr. Seuss maybe with it.
Cat in the Hat.
Yeah. Red fish, blue fish.
Right.
One fish, two fish.
This guy, he was a gangster.
No,
his whole
I was
life.
Not. No, I'm telling you, I got corrupted by Andrew Dice Clay.
Yeah. I get to see you, wife beater on. You're like 2 years old. They start trying to read a nursery.
No, it ain't even like that,
nursery
man.
To you, and you're like. Get the fuck out of here.
Throws a book on the ground, takes a piss on it. That's where they got that photo from. Nah, it's funny, man.
That's a good man. One, Lance.
Yeah, that was a good transo.
Yeah, you want to go into those I found some yearbook photos of Lance.
Oh, man. Oh, yeah, let's see this.
And
wow.
Yeah, yeah.
I think he's sabotaging this. He's gonna,
what
I
are
think
you talking about?
I want to see this. I want to see this.
And listen, there's five of them, and I just think, I don't know, maybe we say what you think he was the head of, maybe, or what did he spend his time doing?
Gotcha.
There's five of them.
I can't wait to see
here
this.
Here we go. Number one. This is 11th grade.
This is like 11th grade.
Is that really you? No, I didn't think so. I'm fucking around.
But it's funny. I would say this. I would say he's, you know, it kind of really, it really does look like, you know, like, damn. But this is like going to the club. Maybe
in the 80s. Like, it's like a.
No, this is like the 2000s. This is maybe going to Sparty's. Mm. Or Harper's for people in Michigan or East Harper's. Lansing that know. Definitely, yeah. You know, people know about Harper's, bro. Yeah, definitely. That's funny. Yeah, that's right. Hilarious.
That's one.
That's when I wore jewelry. What did This looks like get your ass knocked out, Lance.
Yeah, you're watching a lot of Karate Kid.
Oh, Gold Dragon. God, bro. I do envy that hair though.
Is that Cobra Kai? That's a nice hair.
Yeah. That's Cobra Kai before Cobra Kai.
It's a nice hair plant there.
All right, here we go. 3, 2.
Oh wow. Look at that. Yeah, no, that's all American right there. Look,
I could have sent some real basketball pictures there. Yeah, but that's
that
funny.
You got that little stash that everybody had at that age.
Look. Hell yeah. That's exactly how I looked at and in high school too. I mean, for sure. I had a fade, bald fade, so I would have that was shaved on the sides, but. Yeah, that's funny. That's exactly how. I, maybe a little bigger ears, and that's it.
You're like the head of the yearbook or something, or what?
That's remember that meme where that dude was on his phone going like this. That's that tell everybody everything, Lance. Right? Yeah. Definitely.
And then this is the last one.
That looks like my homegirl. I'm gonna
buy
right
that
now.
Fucking turtleneck for you for Christmas, dog. I would love to
with some glasses.
Oh my god, that's hilarious, bro. That's fucking funny shit.
I think this Lance would definitely
probably different versions of Lance.
Yeah, probably get the most girls right there.
That's all of them. That's all.
That is fucking funny.
That's funny, dude. Oh man.
Oh wait a second. I do have a couple more. Oh my god. Joe, what trophy did you win? Was that the science fair?
What the fuck?
The science fair?
It looks like Seinfeld, like he was a main character. One of the main characters.
Oh my god, Ricky, you're gonna have fun with this shit, this bro. Hilarious. This is fucking hilarious. Right, what the fuck?
Oh my god.
Where are you, what kind of music is this guy listening to?
I want it that way. Joey Fortano ass motherfucker. Oh man.
Your baseball photos.
I look like fucking Gary Carter, dude.
That's old boy. That's old boy off of what was it, Angels in Outfield?
Yeah.
What about him?
Slash. I know guys that look like that right now.
Oh, fuck hell yeah.
Alright, here's the last one for Joe.
I can see that right there.
Actually, I could rock that.
I can see that hat, fit
I've
right
worn,
there.
I've worn hats like that.
That's an actual real one.
Real maybe I should try that.
I can see that fit right there for sure. That's definitely
this
something
fucking
you would
guy,
wear.
Bro.
That's amazing.
I made a few more just so you guys weren't mad that so I could be part of the joke as well. There's one of mine.
Thunderstruck. That's funny.
That's you right now. No.
That's you. Oh yeah. Three. That's
I look like it was your friend.
See, Lance, this good looking guy right here. It doesn't matter what photo they put up of him. It looks like it's him.
No.
There's not one.
I can see him doing. You know who he looks like in the Austin Powers when the mini me got all dressed up and shit? That's who he looks like right there.
Bro, I could see him a part of any cast right now with that outfit, doing that, bro.
This is fucking hilarious.
Fucking Marky shit on us, damn it. You could. He really could be a part of it. That's funny.
Oh, man.
Wow. Why do we know? I think I want to. I know where to go now with this. So
where do you want to go?
What is one thing you would change about yourself?
Oh, wow. What are we talking about? Physical attributes?
No, let's not say physical. Physical, we all know what you have to do for physical.
Mental?
Yeah, your emotions. And emotions? Like, what, you know, your mental.
That's a good question. Getting real?
This is all we do on here.
All right. I will say I do play into the cancer traits pretty tough. For people that know what cancer traits at home are, you know, you definitely are emotional sometimes about things. But I feel like I've learned for so long about how to control that at this point, you know. But, I mean, if I would say, like, a full thing about it, I would say maybe just be a little less caring of what people think, you know. And not saying I really care about what everybody thinks, but it's like, you know, you still have that moment where you're like, man, damn, how am I gonna look? You know, like, what is this? How is this? You know, man. So I'll probably be what I'm saying.
So more how people perceive you.
I got
you.
Real right there, bro. You better get
why
real.
Why the fuck you pointing at me? We're not in court.
I'm just saying.
We're just talking among friends here. And you get all...
Hey, I want to hear a real answer.
Well,
from
I will
you.
Give you real answers. Let's what the it. Fuck is wrong with you? Do you know what my name is on the handle, the real Joe Rosati? You want to say some shit like that to me?
I had to fire you up.
Dude. Like, you always try to fire me up, and I don't need to get fired up. I was fired up when I woke up this morning, even though I went to the doctor and looked at my damn eye.
Because I could have went a million different ways, no, but I went that way.
Mine is perception. So, how people perceive me.
So similar.
Yeah, it is similar a little bit. Though there's a couple. I mean, that one. I just use it to my advantage now because it doesn't matter what I do. I think people look at me different. No matter what. And it gets annoying sometimes, and that's my fault.
Right.
And I just need to be who I am. And if you don't like it, go on. Fuck it. But the other thing is
see, this is the real one, y'all.
Yeah. Well, I need to really just take care of me. And I'm not a selfish individual, and right. I will take care of my circle, and I will take care of my people.
Facts.
And those people are... Everywhere in the state, there's a couple outside of the state, but my people that really love me, I really need to take care. I'll take care of them. But other than that, this whole thing about me always helping, and it is a gift, but sometimes I'm taking care of the people not taking care of me.
And overstep it.
I got in a deep conversation with someone the other night, and I was sitting there playing counselor. And when I left, I'm like, well, dude, I got my own shit. And I think we all in here. We always help people out, but it's because we're close. We have a relationship. We have a friendship. Talk about 50-50, but at the end of the day, I really need to take care of me. And that's what I'm really trying to do right now. I'm not trying to take care of everybody else, but if anybody needs anything, I got them. People know if they need something, they can come to me. I will help them if I can. If it's emotionally, physically, if it's financially, whatever, I will do my, you know, I mean, you know what I'm saying? So that's the one thing.
Good shit, man. I think Mark needs to. Mark, you got something for this?
Yeah, I think Joe, for you saying that, I think the word no, because that's oftentimes too what I've learned, because I started saying no to everything.
Yeah.
And oftentimes when you do say no to somebody, it helps you because it protects you and your time and those boundaries, but also it helps them because they needed to hear that no, so they go actually fix the shit versus leaning on us for stuff like that.
Yeah.
The one thing I would change about myself is my, it's a blessing and a curse. I think the thing, what makes me successful in what I'm doing is that I'm so dedicated and I go full throttle.
Right.
But I don't stop until it gets really bad. So taking care of myself and finding that balance of when to like, hey, you know, don't take advantage of your health is the main thing.
Yeah.
Because I've always had a fast metabolism, could eat like shit. And now as things are catching up and I sense things are like, oh, okay, hey, you should chill out on that. But like, oh, I can push it a little bit further.
Right.
And I need to reel that in.
Right. You've been on that too, man.
He's really been so consistent with it. And so the thing consistent. We talk about being consistent in, being consistent in your life and your routines, it's like when we talked about the doctor and he said sleeping, and I go, doc, I go, I have to change it. It's my profession. It's my job, not my profession. My job as a bartender, I mean, you know, doing this whole cloping thing when anybody doesn't know you close and then you open, and at this age, you don't get no sleep. And then, dude, it's just, sleep is so important. I think people don't understand that. And that's what I'm trying to get to now. So I'm.
Well, that's why you chose sleep.
Sleep, baby.
On the previous. I love to sleep.
You know, and that's the whole thing about people and their growth. I mean, you have to make decisions and go with it and get consistent. It's hard. I mean, they've talked about before any successful person, they have the same routine every day.
Yeah. I see that all the
time. And I don't think anybody in this room has the same routine every day. They try to.
Yeah.
But that is.
Mark's definitely closest to it, I'm sure.
Yeah, he is. Yeah. And, you know, and God bless him for it, you know. And
I'm close, but not, yeah.
No, well, you're not. That was your jobs.
Well, I'm just saying, like, as far as how I approach things in life, I need to have a banana and Celsius before I start, you know. And there's just things that I, you know, it's not like I wake up at the exact same time time or nothing
like that.
Do you
do that, Mark? But, you wake up every day at the same time?
Yeah.
Yeah, he does. So that's what I was trying to say.
Yeah, but it did take some, like, big life transitions and, like, you know, that kind of thing. And then, but then for me, I also wasn't sleeping well for about 5 years until I started or stopped eating at 7. And I'm like, okay. Then that allowed me when I was and that's where, you know, we fall off the wagon when you, like, I was dedicated to waking up at the same time, going to the gym early and all that kind of stuff. And I was reading more, I was doing everything better, but then, you know, life gets tough and you get a little tired, drink a little coffee, then next day you're drinking 3 coffees, next, you know, it's...
I can't have one cup of coffee.
I have one cup of coffee,
I'm going to fucking fly out the window.
I think we talked a little bit about what coffee does to me.
I know it does the same thing to me.
I'm on strict espresso now. It's just, I do espresso in the morning, no added, like, even oat milk and all that shit.
Bro, they talk about your boy Campbell. He said in interviews, he gets some tall lattes with like 3 or 4 shots of espresso. I'm like, God damn, bro. That's doing that fucking daily too.
A lot of people are big on that, man, you know, get some rocking. That's what that Celsius does to me. But, you know, there's negatives to that too. So, you know, you never know.
And just finding out that you can have that natural energy. When I was off coffee completely, which I need to get back on again, like even the espresso, at least that's a little bit better for me.
Yeah, it's good.
But I was just, I had energy all day. I didn't have the big ups and downs. I was just smooth all day.
Right.
And I had the energy. So I think we forget about that. That's a possibility. If you're sleeping well, if you're eating well.
Right.
And that's a magical place to be. I wish I could just snap my fingers and get back to it.
Right.
It's not that easy though.
Yeah. Well, it's just teaching you repetition and execution.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You know, because you're putting your mind to it and you're doing it. Right. So then everything else in life, you will be doing the exact same thing. Great, man. Great. I wanted to, can you pull up an image for me, man?
Yep.
I had this little kid ask, you know, in my job, what I do, it was, she goes, it was so cute. She goes, what happens when the river and ocean meet?
Holy shit. So what am I looking at? Can I ask you this?
So, yeah.
Is this the video you sent me? Or
No, I didn't send you any of this. Yeah, I just, if you type it in, what happens when the ocean and river meet? And basically she was just saying like salt water versus fresh water. But there's the image that I'm sure she was looking at. That really was.
So, do we want to read this or no?
Can we go to images? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Like stuff like this. Yeah. So I'm sure she was looking stuff like this up, and I had no idea. Like I had to really go home and ask myself, right? But this is crazy though to think of, huh? Like this is like for instance, I think this might be the Canada one, the one where the Mississippi meets the ocean in Canada. And then there's like one of like the Amazon or maybe the Nile going into the Atlantic Ocean. But isn't that crazy, dude?
Yep. It happens a lot with the salmon. They go from fresh water to seawater all the time, they say.
Yeah, but kids these days, I wasn't thinking about nothing like this.
No.
She goes, it's like the fresh water goes on top and the ocean water goes on the bottom and the middle is called. I'm like, what? I forgot all about this, dude. That's insane.
That's an insane image. No, it is. There's some. That's
an area. So, an estuary is an area where a freshwater river or stream meets the ocean. The salty ocean mixes with the freshwater river, resulting in brackish water.
Yep,
brackish water is somewhat salty, but not as salty as the ocean.
Yep.
An estuary may also be called a bay, lagoon, sound, or slough.
Yeah, that's what she said, the estuary. That's what she was like in the brackish water. I was like, wow. Damn. I know, right? That's crazy.
I just, that was a good one, man. I like that. His left field is all warmed up over there.
Oh, man. That's what we do, bro. Off the script, baby.
Didn't you want to ask Mark a question, too?
I did. You know, because for all you guys that don't know, listening and watching, that Mark really is doing what you guys, you know, think he does and dreams he and what you guys dream of doing. So, like, Mark's really on a great path of you know, I call him a guru, right? That's what I would label you as, man. So I wanted to ask you, man, as advice from a guru.
He's calling you a guru.
For real, dude. This dude is silly serious.
Silly serious.
Hey, Mark. So I wanted to say, what are some of the metrics and indicators you use to measure success in all endeavors, right? So not just like one or two things in life. And we kind of been talking about it already.
Yeah, but, yeah.
You know, I wanted to read that question to you, man, because I thought that would be dope to hear your answer for listeners at home.
I think the only metric, because you can get real specific with like our social media clients, or like everybody wants, like, how soon am I going to grow, or how fast am I going to make this business? How much am I going to make the money back?
See?
And like, once you remove all of that and you do find a way to meet yourself in the middle of having so much the sense of urgency that you need it tomorrow, but the patience, you don't need it for 10 years. Once you find yourself in the middle where you don't think about either of them too much, it allows you to find forward progress.
Right.
So that's the only metric that I really focus on. And because, you know, sometimes you take 5 or 10 steps back and you're able to analyze, but then your future is going to be way more forward and better and more profitable and successful because you learned that lesson, you're able to recalibrate and then move forward again.
Right.
So I think forward progress is the only metric that actually matters, because once you put too much emphasis on the other metrics that don't necessarily matter, that's how you really start stunting your growth because you're worrying about things.
Right.
And it gets tricky when money's involved and that kind of thing too. So, but yeah, I think forward progress is really the once you fall in love with that, then nothing else matters, and then the other stuff comes because of it.
Right.
What I would say.
That was well, very well said, Mark.
Absolutely, man.
Because I remember I had a person a long time ago tell me that, you know, sometimes you got to re-kick, or you got to re-punt or whatever, and it was a reference. But the thing is, I'll be looking forward to the time where I don't have to re-kick anymore.
Yeah.
And getting there is like, I think, you know, sometimes, not to take anything away from what you said, but it's a lot of trial and tribulations, trial and error, and just keep on going and be consistent. And it's nice that I'm being consistent now. You know, you are, and I know how consistent you are, what you do and your plan, and how you try to help out people all the time is just a beautiful fucking thing over here. So,
thanks, man. You know. Well, I just love it. Like, that's like, even like, with, no matter what it is, like, it's forward progress, seeing a name, how we came up the name last minute.
Right.
And like, okay, we see the forward progress. We see the different styles and designs until you get something. It's like, okay, now we got this. And it's always like a good, better, best technique, no matter what you're doing.
Right.
It's like,
no, it is. I mean, you have to, when you get minds together, want to go to one place, it's beautiful. And, you know, and getting there, and then a lot of people try to do that, and they have teams, and they form teams. And it's just like when you look at football.
Yeah.
They all have this, in the beginning of the season, they get the Super Bowl. Well, then shit happens, and then you find out who's strong and who's not. That's where coaching comes in.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I think I would love to see you talk to Dan Campbell one day.
Yeah,
I'm being serious. That's some real shit about that guy.
Yeah, I'm loving everything I'm seeing.
Yeah, I mean, but it's been going. It took him a little bit, but he's getting there. He's getting it there. So I'm excited for him. So,
yeah, man.
Likewise.
Yeah, definitely. What you guys just all said is amazing. You know, because it was, you know, think tanks and a lot of stuff to get people to places they want to. But I think also, you know, a measure of success is what you set the bar at. Right?
Yeah.
Well, because there's like people that are broke and have own land and own one car, and that's all they want, you know. But like, it's kind of just where you want to set the
figuring
mark,
yourself
right?
out.
Yeah, exactly.
I was talking to this young writer. She was interning for us for a while, and she was talking about writing this piece. And when you write a script, if you just get a first draft done, if you just write everything out, just write it. You don't have to overcalculate and think how to make this part perfect. And I think at the end of the day, once I said this, it really could be mapped over onto life.
Right.
It's like a lot of the stuff that you do, say later on in the script, if you just continue writing, you might figure out something else that's going to inform the beginning as well. So if you're living your life and you're not getting anything done because you're so worried about making this one thing perfect versus continuous forward progress, something you learned down the road could inform what you were working on before, and then everything gradually builds together.
So true.
And same with songwriting. Yes. You know, when you have something, a piece of art or a business or whatever, it's fully baked because you've been baking it for like however long.
Right.
And then that first verse is dope because of what you said in the bridge that you brought back into the little Easter egg. That's where you make those like dynamic pieces.
So well said, man.
Yeah,
definitely, definitely. It's the same. That's exactly how you write songs. You know,
that's right.
You might go through stuff for a while, and then you know you get that little, even coming up with the title or something. But yeah, for sure, man.
And sometimes it might flow and be perfect the first time.
But yeah,
but you got to be in there. It's in like there.
It's so funny.
Be in it.
Where you want to take this, man?
I think we will just wrap it up.
Wrap it on up.
Wrap it all up.
I think they're tired of hearing our bullshit.
They might a little bit. I don't think it's bullshit. I think people get something out, have fun of it. Yeah. So
we've been rocking for a minute. For sure.
Exactly. So I wanted to thank everybody for watching today. And second episode of Off the Script is done. And what a fun time it was. So we'll be looking forward to doing this again soon. So.
Yes. Yeah. Where can they find you, Big Dog?
The Real Joe Rosati. And probably some other places, but I'm not going to talk about it. You might be able to find me anywhere. You never know.
So we dropped the first episode already.
Yeah.
Go check that out. It's Off the Script Podcast on YouTube. We're on Spotify. We're rocking everywhere, guys. Go and follow the Instagram. Follow his handle, and then @IM_IllSun. That's our side of it. And look forward to some great content, man.
It was just fun. It's hilarious. It's hilarious.
Yeah, man, for sure. So let's do a Charlemagne. Where are we rocking from, right?
You know I don't sing, man. I look like a soprano. I don't sing like one. That's always my thing. I love it.
I'm bullshitting.
I know you are. All
right. I think that's it, right?
All right. Yeah.
Subscribe.
Let's go. We just gotta go hard.